welcome, everybody. Thanks for attending. Thanks for coming to this talk. So my name is Michael Jackson. Here's my friend Domenic Denicola.
Hey, guys.
And we are going to co-present on this topic. Just to give you a clue how cool Domenic is, he and I first met in person about 6 hours ago. So we are going to be talking about this topic together. I invited Domenic to speak with me because he's done a ton of work on this topic, and a lot of this presentation comes from work that he has done as well. So he's going to be a huge addition to this presentation, I'm sure. So we want to talk about a little concept known as, commonly referred to as callback hell, okay? And some people say this is like a mythical place that doesn't exist. I disagree. I think callback hell is a very real and hellish place. And it's easy to get stuck there, but it would be too easy for me right now to throw up on the slide like some example, right? Some nasty, like nested six layers deep example of callbacks chained together. Instead, I want to go a little bit deeper, okay? I want to talk about why we get there in the first place. Like, what is a callback? And in order to do that, we're going to need to talk about asynchronous APIs, okay? What is an asynchronous API? What is the difference between a synchronous API and an asynchronous API? Let's have a look at this example. So this is a pretty simple function. A lot of you probably have a very similar function in apps that you're building, right? This function is called getUser, and we're going to pass in a name, a username, or a handle. We're going to execute some SQL query to our relational database, and we're going to get back a user. If we don't get a user, we want this function to throw an error and say, you didn't find a user with that handle. Otherwise, we'll just return the user object that we got back from the database. Pretty straightforward, right? Except we've got this query function that's kind of interesting. It's kind of a pain point for us, because what it is it's blocking. So what that means is we go to the database, we make a call, and we basically wait on that open database connection, and our thread can't do anything else until that call comes back, and then we can proceed with the rest of this function, right? So this is a huge problem in a single-threaded environment like JavaScript, where you don't really have any real concurrency. Instead, you have these things called as events. You might have done some programming in Node.js, and there's just this massive event loop. And what you do is you do something that's a little bit more like this instead. So what you'll say is, now my function signature has changed, right? Instead of one argument called name, I've got two arguments. I pass in name and a callback. And basically what I'm saying with this function is, it's the exact same as the last function, except it's not blocking. I can call this function, and I can give it as the second argument another function that says, when you're done talking to the database, when you get that object back, I want you to call this function with the result. I want you to call my callback with the result, okay? Our query function we've also changed in this slide to be non-blocking. So now, instead of just taking a string of SQL and any parameters to interpolate into that SQL query, we've now got a callback in the query function as well. A common pattern in Node that you'll see, at least, is that when you have a callback, the first argument will be an error, any error that occurred when you called the callback, and the second argument will be the result that you're actually interested in. So this is not too far out there, right? If there was an error, we call the callback with an error to let the user know that there's something happened. Otherwise, if we don't have a user, well, that's an error too, so let's give them that the error that says there's no user. Otherwise, there was no error, and the callback gets the user object, and null as the error argument because there was no error. Is this making sense to everybody? Does this look pretty familiar? Okay. This isn't too far out there. This example isn't too contrived. Let's take a look at them side by side. The top function is a synchronous function, fully synchronous. We call it, we get a user object back, but we have to wait on the database call. The second function, we don't have to wait for the database to get back at all. Instead, we give it a function called a callback, and it calls that for us later. Does anybody notice, like, what is the difference between these two functions? Like, is anything that jumps out to anybody? Look at the keywords in the function on the top, and look at the keywords in the function on the bottom. There are two keywords in particular in the top function that are missing from the bottom. The first one is return. Okay? Let's take another look. In a callback, you can't call return, right? Nobody is there to get your return value. If I were to write the callback like this and say return user, nobody's ever going to get that value. Okay? The second thing that you can't do in a callback is throw. Okay? If you throw inside a callback, nobody's there to catch it, because you've got a brand new call stack. You left that old call stack behind when you registered that callback. So you don't have that call stack anymore. So if you wrote some code like this, if there was an error, throw the error, nobody could possibly catch that. This is bad. This is actually particularly bad in an environment like Node, where you're building servers, because you're just throwing an error, and this one line will actually crash your entire program. Okay? Even though you actually see this, this is a really bad practice, but you see this all the time in Node library docs, and it kind of drives me crazy. Have you seen this before? Who's seen this pattern before? If error, throw error. Right? It's ridiculous, right? You can't throw the error. Nobody's going to catch it. You're going to crash your process. So in a callback, summary, we don't have return. We don't have throw. Also that we could get asynchronous. OK, so maybe we can deal without return and throw. But then once you start writing a lot of code like this, and I was writing a lot of code like this about 6 months ago, and I thought, man, this kind of sucks, because I don't have return, I don't have throw, I don't have a stack. Okay? That old stack that I used to have, that I was executing on when I called that get user function, I departed from that stack. So I lose all semantics of a stack. You don't normally think about a stack, right? A stack is like one of those things that just sort of happens for you. It's one of those things that the language gives you. But you throw it away when you go asynchronous. Another problem with the callback approach is that you really don't have any guarantees. Okay? What do I mean by that? I mean, how many times does your callback get called, for example? Does it get called 0 times? Does it get called more than once? Does it get called exactly once? Does it get called with the same arguments every single time? Or does it get called with different arguments every single time? How many functional programmers do we have in here? Functional programmers? What can functions do? In JavaScript, functions can do at least 3 things. They can return, they can throw, or they can have side effects. We've essentially chucked out return and throw, and we're relying purely on side effects, the side effect being call the callback.
Just to interject, you know, it's kind of common to say, you know, this isn't a real problem. You know, there's a well-understood contract. We're only going to call our callback back once, or we're only going to call it back with an error and the result. We're never going to call it back with both. But you know, you can actually find some very prominent examples in the history, the Git history, of very important libraries where this is not the case, right? So like Express had a very bad bug in the 2.x timeframe, where you know, if it tried to trap the error from JSON parse and then call the callback back with that, but it had already called the callback back with the result. And you know, this is the kind of stuff that happens when you're in a world where you're using this very basic function call to communicate your control flow. You don't have any guarantees, and you will get bugs like this, and you'll be spending your time tracking it down. I can't imagine the poor programmer who got bit by that, that filed that bug, and then TJ had to get around to looking at it and saying, oh, wow, that was a brain-dead mistake. I wish I'd had a language that protected me from that, but I'm using callbacks. He probably didn't say that last part. But.
Who can see the bug here? Raise your hand when you see it. What's the bug in this function? Yeah. Not catching the else. Okay, that's, you're talking about that last if users.length equals names.length? Is that what you're talking about? Okay, so that's just a little guard, and all that's doing is saying, once we're done with all of our callbacks, then call the main callback. So I don't think that that's a bug. though. Does anybody else see? Let me give you a clue. What happens if I pass in two invalid usernames into this function? Right? The first argument is an array of usernames. What happens if I pass two invalid ones in? Yeah. Yeah. My callback gets called twice, right? Can you imagine a function throwing twice? No, right? But that's what happens here, right? Because you don't have the same guarantee that a synchronous call stack gives you, okay? These are subtle bugs, and they're a pain in the butt to track down. Because you look at like a lot of code and you're like, I don't really see it, but there are bugs, okay? It's easy to get these kinds of bugs. So in summary, callbacks, you don't have a stack. What I mean by that is you're not on the original call stack. You're on a completely new call stack, which means return and throw, you can't use them in a callback. You have no guarantees about how that function is going to work. Just basically says it in the docs, but there aren't any functional guarantees. But at least we don't block, right? So we threw away a lot of stuff just so that we could get asynchronous, so we didn't have to have a synchronous query call. Is it worth it? We threw away some core parts of the language just so we could get this. I hope it's worth it. Okay, so I think we can kind of see like where this comes from, right? Like why callback hell exists in the first place? Why is it a real thing? Let's take a look at where we're going. Okay, so the future is ES6 generators. How many people have kind of browsed around the ES6 API, you've seen the generator thing? It's pretty cool, right? What it lets you do is stuff like this. Okay, notice we've got that yield keyword there on the fourth line of our, or on the third line rather, of the body of our Fibonacci function. Okay? Basically what we're going to do here is we're going to print out the first 12 numbers of the Fibonacci sequence. But notice what happens when we call the Fibonacci function. We get back an object, right? A first class object. We can take that object, we can pass it around to other functions, we can call methods on it. In this case, we call the next method on it to generate the next number in the Fibonacci sequence. These are awesome. They're first class coroutines. They'll be really good for doing async stuff because you can just suspend the current execution context. You could get halfway through a function, suspend it to go and do some I/O, come back with the result, and continue with your function. That's awesome. One thing that I really like about generators is there's a super tiny API, right? There's a yield keyword and a next function. That's it. Simple solutions to complex problems. Unfortunately, it's not available yet, okay? We can't use generators yet. They're in ES6. You can run some stuff in the SpiderMonkey shell if you want to play around with it, and that's kind of fun. But you can't use this in your apps yet, okay? So what do we do in the meantime? There's a word up here called promise. Promises, A+, okay? How many people have heard of promises? Deferreds, futures, okay? I'm going to let Domenic talk about promises and promises A+ in particular, because he was very instrumental in coming up with the specification. Go ahead.
Thanks for the great intro. Everybody's heard of promises, it seems. We got a lot of hands. How many have heard of promises A+ in particular? Yeah, it's a much smaller number. So what you kind of need to do, and this is the reason we spent so much time setting this up, is reset what you know about promises, what you know about deferreds, what you know about future, what you've heard about jQuery, and all that. Like, you need to kind of step back, because there's some bad implementations out there that really don't get the point of promises. So we need to go back to the beginning and kind of like look at what this pattern really was meant to address. And I'll give you a hint. You know, we've kind of been talking about what it's meant to address for the previous 20 slides. But back in the beginning, you know, they're discovered, you know, by computer science researchers as these people discover things. You know, about 1989, the E programming language created by Mark Miller and others is really kind of where they first came into fruition in their current form. And this is a really, really interesting language where, you know, it's JavaScript style with event loops and you know, share nothing concurrency, but it made promises a first class part of the language, and made them like, you know, they were really a big part of it. And Mark Miller, who created the language, is now on TC39, the committee that creates the next version of JavaScript. So that's pretty cool. But you know, beyond just their original creation in E and so on, they're actually used in a lot of modern languages too, under various names. You know, Python has futures, Twisted deferreds, .NET has TaskT. You know, there's tons of different, you know, C++, std, :, future. You know, there's lots of these implementations in these languages. It's kind of been a convergent evolution upon this pattern, this promise pattern of how to manage your asynchronicity in a way that's well integrated into the language. So kind of I want to tell a story about how promises in JavaScript kind of ended up. Because back in the day, back in the days when CommonJS was a very important mailing list, you know, they came up with this thing called CommonJS Promises A. And you know, a group called jQuery, who you might have heard of, saw this and they're like, oh, that'd be cool. We should have those because we have XHRs and we need to manage the asynchronicity there. And they implemented kind of a very bad version of CommonJS Promises A. And that's kind of really poisoned people's minds against them, thinking that you don't get a lot out of them. And so, you know, I'm off in happy promise land using good promises for this from this other library. But, you know, it's a minority. Not many people know. But what happens is, you know, so this pull request gets opened on Ember, this project I'm watching on GitHub. It says, add ember.deferred mixin, which implements the promises A spec. And, you know, I take a look at the code pretty quickly, and I find out that these are actually horrible, horrible lies. It does not implement anything like the promises A spec. It's even worse than jQuery's implementation in many ways. So, you know, this is kind of like the last straw for me. I'm just beleaguered minority saying, yo, let's, promises are really about, you know, this really cool stuff, but you're missing the point. And so I wrote this long rant originally in a gist about called "You're Missing the Point of Promises." And I, you know, this made the rounds, Hacker News, so on and so forth. But you know, I think it really brought a lot of clarity to people on what exactly is the point of promises. And that's what Michael's been getting at, and what we'll discuss exactly how it all fits together. But I mean, the idea is, you know, okay, I wrote an angry rant on the internet, but what good does that do anyone? So recognizing this, I didn't want to just be that guy who writes things. I actually did something about it. So I created the promises A test suite. Okay, so the idea here is that I had an automated suite of tests that any promises A library, any library that wanted to implement promises A, could plug in and could say, oh, you did it right. Oh, you did it wrong. You know, you're missing the point. You're jQuery and you're letting the promise have multiple fulfillment values. That's actually kind of missing the point. You can't return multiple values from a function. Things like that. And this was really cool. Like this you got to see exactly where libraries like jQuery fell down, libraries like Ember deferred that in that pull request. And it inspired a lot of interesting work. So, you know, going back to Ember, Yehuda Katz, who spoke this morning and put together, was responsible for much of Ember, put together this library called rsvp.js specifically to pass the Promises A test suite I created to say, okay, let's put together a real good implementation that everybody can use and that we can use in Ember. And that's pretty cool just by itself, that we transformed this spec from a document sitting on a almost forgotten CommonJS wiki into a test suite, an executable spec really, that people could write code against and that started gaining some traction. But then things got really awesome. So there's this guy called Brian Cavalier, who's responsible for the promise library when.js. And he created this gist called promise, and he called it Promises A Plus. You know, it's a pun on the Promises A name, saying, you know, Promises A was pretty good, but part of the reason people are getting it wrong is because it's underspecified. It's missing some details. It doesn't, you know, go into what happens in this edge case. You know, it says maybe you could do this, but because of performance, some people have chosen to do this. You know, it wasn't really clear. What we ended up doing, you know, him and me and a few other implementers, including Yehuda, over the course of the next 3 or 4 or 5 months, was putting together an actual, you know, up-to-date spec called Promises A Plus. And so here we are, you know, 5 months later, and we have this beautiful spec document hosted on GitHub. And I think it's really interesting the way we developed this. We, you know, this isn't something we submitted to a standards body, or we wrote up once and then put up there. We developed this on GitHub in the open. We had people who we'd never seen before come in and open issues and say, I don't understand this, could you clear this up, or I think you missed this, or so on and so forth. It ended up being a really impressive process that I think we were all really happy with. You know, implementer driven, but also community driven. So you can go check it out. We have a pretty sweet logo at this website. And it's just, I mean, it's pretty technical, but it's supposed to be. And of course it comes with a really comprehensive test suite saying, you know, this is exactly how it should behave. These are all the edge cases. So when you're going to use this promise pattern, this is how your promises really, this is the minimal contract everyone needs to share. And so out of this, there's emerged, I think, three kind of leading implementations. There's Q, a library I work on, which is very full-featured, you know, one of the originals. There's RSVP, Yehuda's newcomer to the scene, highly recommended. And there's Wen, which is Brian, who started this all, you know, his implementation, which is, you know, quite impressive. But, you know, if you go to this wiki page we have, there's also like 30 others. You know, people, one of the things I learned is once you make a spec, people just start wanting to implement it just for fun. So you should try that sometime if you've got a problem you want solved. But you know, I just see new implementations scroll by in my Twitter feed every once in a while. So I'm going to turn it back over to you to kind of get into, you know, this is the standards process. This is what we accomplished. But what is the value add here? What's the proposition? Why are promises so important?
So what I want you to think of is I want you to kind of burn this phrase into your mind, okay? So a promise is an asynchronous value, okay? It is an object, it's a first class object that at some point in the future will have a value, okay? But for right now, it's just an object, okay? So we can call a method and we can return this object. Let's take a look at, oh gosh, yeah, you know, forget that slide. I'm going to talk about four basic transforms, okay? Going from synchronous code to asynchronous code. And hopefully this idea of an asynchronous value will kind of start to sink in, okay? So on the top, we've got some synchronous code. Again, our get user function, let's pretend it's synchronous, and it returns a user object. Pretty basic. Var user is get user with this username. And then on the next line, I can immediately pull properties off of that object. Great. Get the user's name. If that function, instead of returning a user, if that function returned a promise for a user, we would call the function, and then here's the method signature. Then, oh, you know what? I actually needed to go into this slide. I'm sorry. Let's look at the bottom first. So then is a function that requires that has two arguments. Okay. This is the spec, two arguments. The first argument is a fulfillment handler. Okay, it is a function that you use to say, this is the value of the promise. Okay, the second function that gets passed to then is a rejection handler, which says, this is the value, this is the reason for which this promise is not valid. Okay, the parallels here are return and throw, right? If you call the first function, it's just like calling return from a synchronous function. If you call the second function, it's like throwing from a synchronous function, okay? Similar to a synchronous function, once you call one of these functions, once you call either one, any future calls to either one is a no-op, okay? That's just like a synchronous function, right? Once you return, any further returns in that function are no-ops. You stopped executing the body of that function, right? Similar to throw, once you throw in a function, you don't execute any more code. That's it. All future returns and throws are no-ops, okay? Do you see the parallel? Okay, so I wanna get back into talking about these transforms. In this first case, it's just a basic functional transform, okay? I'm taking this get user function that's synchronous on the top, I'm making it asynchronous on the bottom. In my fulfillment handler, which is my first argument to then, that anonymous function, I get back the user object as an argument. Great. That means the promise was fulfilled. That would be just like returning normally from a function. Okay. Let's take a look now at this synchronous code on the top. I say var user is get user with this username. If there's no user, I'm going to throw an error, right? This happens all the time in synchronous code. If there's some condition, throw. Okay. The promise equivalent for that pattern up that you're seeing up at the top is on the bottom. So in my fulfillment handler, in other words, I get back a user object. Okay. That means there were no problems. Nobody threw. Okay, from downstream on this promise call stack, right? Nobody threw. I got back a user object. But, oh, sorry, I put if bang timeline. What I meant to put was if bang user. Throw error new user, okay? Otherwise, return user.name, okay? So this is just like throwing an error in a normal synchronous call stack, except you're in a promise call stack. Here's another synchronous pattern that you see very often, which is catching and safely handling an error, right? Instead of just like throwing it out into the ether, right? You're going to try to deliver, you know, this deliver tweet to function could possibly throw, okay? This is a synchronous function that could possibly throw. In this case, we want to catch it. We don't want that error to bubble up and bust further up the call stack. We want to catch it and do some handling logic on it, okay? In promise land, what this becomes is instead of returning immediately or throwing immediately, deliver tweet to actually returns a promise. Okay? In this case, we're going to say our then function, we call dot then on the last line, gets two arguments. The first one is not defined. We haven't defined what we want to do in case we get a successful user object or in case the delivery is successful. But the second one is what we want to do in case there is an error. That makes sense? I'm going to handle the error if there's an error. So this is just like a catch. Okay? So we've seen return, throw, catch, and there's a fourth thing that we normally do in synchronous code, and that is rethrow. In other words, take a look at the top example. I executed this get user function, it threw, I've got an error, and I want to throw that again. Maybe I want to add some metadata information or whatever. This is like a compound error, right? I want to rethrow this thing. You have that exact same pattern in promise style if you get user returns a promise instead of returning synchronously. Basically, your second function takes an error and you're just rethrowing. Okay? Does that make sense? This will hopefully make a little bit more sense as we move on. The important thing to get here is to go back to the fact that all of these functions, all of the operations that you have available to you in a synchronous call stack, in a synchronous world, are available to you in an asynchronous world now. Return, throw, catch, and rethrow. Okay? I think the slide's a duplicate. So what you get back, what promises give back to you, is they give you asynchronicity, but they also give you a call stack, okay? It's a promises call stack. You can return meaningful objects now from your functions. You can throw when errors happen. And those sorts of things will meaningfully propagate back up the promise chain. It also gives you some guarantees. I was talking about how if you call the fulfillment handler, if you call the error handler more than once, or the rejection handler more than once, how that's a no-op. Right? You have these guarantees. In callback land, you don't have those guarantees. You can call the callback, you can not call the callback, you could call it multiple times, for example. Okay, so let's get into what happens how do we use these sorts of patterns in like more real world programs, right? So let's say we want to have multiple things happen when we call we want to like propagate values, right? Propagate the result of one operation to the next. In other words, we want to do operations in sequence. Okay? So let's say, for example, I want to get a user. Let's say I'm working at Twitter. I want to get a user object. I'm going to get all the tweets for that user. And then I want to go update his timeline. Okay? This is pretty, there's code somewhere in Twitter that does something like this, I'm sure. Up top, we see the synchronous. That's how it happens. We could totally understand that, right? In the middle example, we're using callbacks, right? This is how we propagate values or propagate the results of one callback to another function, right? It's basically we got this nesting that occurs. We get the user. Good. In the callback, we've got the user. Now we say get the tweets for the user. Okay, in that callback, now we have the tweets. Now we can finally update the timeline, okay? Do you see how the code pretty quickly creeps to the right? Have any of you had this problem? We've had like code indenting kind of quickly to the right. Using promises, we get back an object instead of getting back nothing from the get user, from the call to get user. We get back an object, a promise for that user. So notice that the first argument to our first then is get new tweets. In other words, once you have the result from the get user call, pass whatever that object is to get new tweets. Once you have the result from that call, pass whatever that object is to the update timeline function. Right? So chaining becomes super simple in promise land, and things don't creep out to the right so quickly. But that's just the happy path, right? Let's assume that like our code actually has exceptions and it throws and it does things that like real code does, right? Because any number of things could have failed in that sequence of operations. That was pretty complex. It's probably talking to lots of different services, et cetera. So let's pretend that we've got these synchronous functions now, and they any one of them could throw. And if any one of them throws, we want to be able to handle the error in a sane way. We don't want that error to crash our program, okay? So let's take a look at what does this look like using callbacks. Take a look at that for a second. Get the user. Okay, on the next line, if there was an error, handle the error. Otherwise, we can proceed. Now get the new tweets. Now look at the next line. Okay, if there was an error, handle the error. Otherwise, we can proceed. Update the timeline. Right? At every single step of the way, we've got like this manual handling, right? Because we don't have a call stack, right? We can't throw that thing. We have to like do something with it. I don't know. Give it to this handle error function, if there is one. If not, keep going with something else. How many people have seen this pattern creeping into their code? Right? It's like all over the place, right? And it kind of drives me crazy. Or you can do this. This always makes me laugh when I see this. Like, people write code like this, you know, like on wikis and stuff, and they're like, if there was an error, throw the error. Like, we'll all go home and have a beer afterwards. Like, your server's crashing, you know? Like, the only thing that you can do, this is node code, by the way, the only thing that you can do in that situation is, like, register your handler on this, like, magic event that happens on the process object called uncaught exception. That's basically, like, your process is going down. Any last words before we shut the whole thing down? Yeah, how about this? Do that function before you totally die. So that's just not an option. Yeah.
And I think what's really funny about this example is that, you know, this is obviously code you would hope not to see. You might see it, but you know, you promptly upbraid that person in the code review. But only a slight variation of this code is using a feature of Node called domains, which is their solution for error handling, which is just basically, let's say there's this global state, which is what current domain we're in, and that gets an uncaught exception handler. And everything that happens inside that domain while that global state is active will go to the uncaught exception handler for that domain. And so they don't have any real story for how to propagate values up a call stack. They just say, well, let's add this global state, and if something bad happens while that global state is active, then we'll do the uncaught exception and isolate it to that domain. It's just like this hacky patch on top of what was already a pretty hacky pattern. But you know, it's what they got. It's if you don't have the proper tools for the job, you end up having to do stuff like that.
Totally. Thank you. Yeah. So it's so how many people like this pattern? Fail fast, right? Fail real fast. Using promises, this example might be a little bit difficult to understand. But what did I say about promises? Using promises, you get back a call stack, right? Which means you can propagate stuff right back up the chain. You can propagate these errors. You can propagate return values right back up the stack, just like you can with normal function calls. So let's check out what is going on in this example, in this second example. I say get user M Jackson. Okay, if that succeeds, then get new tweets. If that succeeds, then update the timeline. And I've got a last then down there that says that's essentially it's undefined if you succeed at that point. But what happens is if any one of those steps fails, what then will return is it will immediately return a rejected promise. Well, not immediately on the next tick, but it'll give you a rejected promise. And that rejection propagates all the way back to the first catch, so to speak, right? This is why we looked at the transforms, right? This is essentially a try-catch using promises, okay? So you get back catch. Yeah? Yeah. Yep. Nope. It's going to skip it entirely. Yeah, it's going to skip. Just like if, look at the top example. So if get user up there, if that thing throws, where do we go? We go straight to the catch. We don't call get new tweets. We don't call update timeline. We don't call any of that. We go straight to the catch. Same thing in promises. If get user fails, now it's returning a promise, remember. It's not throwing directly. It's returning a promise that is rejected. If that promise is rejected, that error propagates through the chain. Get new tweets is not called because that's a success handler. You only call that thing if the previous promise succeeded. That didn't succeed. So all we get from get user dot then get new tweets, all we get is a rejected promise. Why? Because get user failed. On the subsequent dot then, same thing. It's another rejected promise. On the subsequent dot then, same thing, except this time we've got a handler for it. We've got a catch, right? How many people think this is like awesome? How many people think this like totally changes the way about how they do asynchronous programming in JavaScript? Yeah, I was looking at this, I was building a large app, and I was like, holy crap, there's an error at this low level. Like, I took the HTTP request. I like validated the session. I did all this stuff. And then like there's some error argument down here that to some godforsaken callback. And I don't know what to do with it, right? There's no way for me to propagate this thing back up to the top level. I've got to call some callback. I'd like to hold off on questions because we've got to get through a lot of stuff. But I just want to show you that we've got catch back in, and these slides are going to be available, so you don't need to take pictures. I'll put the slides up. Okay. Unfortunately, there's a lot of FUD going around about promises. There are a lot of people who are like, oh, callbacks are like the thing, and they're everything, and they're so cool, and promises, I don't even know what they are, so you can't use them because they're not compatible with the rest of something or other. So we just want to dispel some of the FUD, okay? Promises are totally awesome. You can use them anywhere. I'm going to leave this part to Domenic.
All right. Yeah, I mean, yeah, there is a lot of FUD. That's all. We'll leave it at that. But how can you use promises with your existing code, right? Because that's what the FUD is. It's saying, oh, if you use promises, nobody will ever use your code. And if you use promises, you can't use the 26,000 modules on NPM because then, you know, those don't use promises and it's bad. This is just completely not true, okay? So it's the job of a well-done promise library to make this interop work for you, to bridge the gap between the old world of callbacks and the future with promises. And they really are the future for reasons, we'll see. Yeah, okay. So the first thing you can do is if you're using Node, you're like, oh, well, I've got this whole FS thing, and it's got lots of useful functions for dealing with the file system, but none of them return promises. Bummer. Or is it? You can use this, so Q and all the other libraries have functions called like denotify, which will take a Node function that uses a callback and turn it into one that returns a promise. This is a pretty cool thing about JavaScript, just unrelated to this, is that you can do these kind of crazy things with other people's functions. But yeah, you've got this new function called readFile that returns a promise, and boom, there you go. ReadFile with a file name, you got a promise, you can do all your nice error handling, you can do those kind of chains that we saw on the last slide. So that's the first thing, is that you can use callback using libraries if you want to buy into a promise-based stack. There's no problem with that. The second thing is, you know, what about, you know, if you write a library Or you write an app and you're using promises. People are like, oh, no, nobody will ever use your app, or nobody will ever use your promises. Well, people probably use your app because, you know, the users on Facebook don't care if when you click the button it's promises or callbacks. But will they use your library? Well, there's a really easy way around that too. And this is a solution that Q has. So let's say we're creating this create user function, and it's got complicated error handling logic, and we want to use promises internally. But then we want to expose an API for those poor callback users stuck back in the 2000s. Well, for those people, we just have this function called notify, which Q puts on all of its promises. You pass it a callback, and what this means is that if there is a callback, right, so if the user calls the function create user with a node callback, it'll call the callback for you. It'll take care of it. It'll send the error if there's an error. It'll send the first param being the user if there's a user, or success, or whatever. But if there's no callback, then it'll just return the promise. So people who call your API, your create user, with no callback will get a promise-based API. And they can move forward into the future and use things like ES6 generators and all that stuff. And speaking of the future, right? Like, you know, that's the other FUD is, no, we're stuck with callbacks forever. We're never going to get promises. Well, you know, promises are everywhere. They're in Ember. They're in Angular. They're in jQuery in a crippled form. They're in Dojo. They're in everything. Like, and furthermore, just recently, promises were added to the DOM spec. They have a weird name called futures, and they changed a few words because they wanted to feel like they accomplished something instead of just lifting the A+ spec. But they are coming to the DOM, and it's really awesome. We're going to have these in our browsers. There's active bugs and patches in the Mozilla and WebKit trackers to get these working. And generators, you know, they're already here in Firefox, but they're also coming to V8. There's a guy that's sponsored to work on them on the V8 bug. So that means we're going to get them in Node. And generators plus promises means that you can write the kind of code that we'll see in just the next slide. So promises are very future-proof. They are the way of the future, I'd say. And you should probably get on the promise train. So speaking of the future, right? Here's how it's going to look with ES6 and generators and promises. You're going to take your function. And remember the sync code we had that looked pretty nice? You can just do a slight wrapper around that and do this q.async, which takes a sync-looking function and turns it into one that's an async one that returns a promise. So this function, even though you were able to write it nicely with like no promise machinery involved, it actually returns a promise. And the key is this yield keyword, right? You're saying yield query. And here, query is a method that, or a function that returns a promise. And yield says, oh, suspend the execution context while that promise comes back. If there's an error, throw it. And if there's a no error, then return to the function and continue with the rest of the code. So because of how generators are these kind of first-class coroutines, you can write little libraries like this q.async helper, which transform generator-based code when combined with promises into something that looks very nice, very synchronous. You can get all your keywords back, not even any of this promise kind of like little tricks. So I think this is really awesome, and I'm really looking forward to using this in Node. I think this will make everybody's life a lot easier.
So let's talk about something that async code should be really, really good at, right? One of the reasons we use async stuff is because we don't want to block anywhere. We want to do lots of stuff in parallel, right? We want lots of operations to be going on in parallel. We want to have many hundreds or thousands of concurrent users accessing our web server, all with persistent connections, that type of thing, right? So what do we do? How do we do operations in parallel using promises? So you could imagine a synchronous function that does something like this. You know, get new tweets for users. Say you've got an array of user objects. You want to get all the new tweets for them. You want to essentially return an array of arrays, right? A multidimensional array. You might do something like the following, right? For each of those users, you want to execute this function called getNewTweets and return the result of that. In a promise library, most promise libraries ship with this method called all. Look at the second to last line. We say return q.all, okay? Q has this function called all, where you can take an array of promises, right? In this second function on the bottom, our getNewTweets function, instead of returning immediately, it returns a promise. Okay, so we've got all these promises, and we say, Q, as soon as all of these promises are resolved, I want you to aggregate the results and resolve the promise that you returned to me from the getNewTweetsForUsers function. Okay. What's super cool about this is that if any one of those calls fails, what happens? What do you get back? You just get a rejected promise, right? Can you imagine how crazy that would look like if you were doing it in callback style? Like, callbacks really don't do parallel very well. You usually have some sort of a counter which keeps track of whether or not you've called all, you've returned from all of your asynchronous functions. You also have some sort of an aggregator that's aggregating the results. You also usually have some sort of a flag that says whether or not you've called the callback. But it's really easy with promises. So that's executing results in parallel. One thing that's really, really cool is because of this error propagation that you get back, it makes it really easy to build fault-tolerant things, like, I don't know, servers, right? When I first watched the JSConfEU talk that Ryan Dahl gave about Node, where he was like talking about Node for the very, very first time, it was awesome because he was like, Node is a really easy way to build high-performance servers, right? That was the thing. Like, that was why Node was created, was to build servers. So in an environment like Node, where you're building servers, it's really nice to have this error propagation so that you don't have errors, crashing your program. You know what's funny about this example right here, actually, is that Domenic and I both kind of came to this this example, this kind of conclusion, completely independently of one another, right? Let's take a look at this code and kind of dissect what it's doing. And you might have written an HTTP server in Node and kind of had this problem, right? What happens when you have an error somewhere further down the stack, right? How do you not crash your server, but at the same time, give a response to that client to let them know like something happened, in this case a 500 error page, right? The first couple of lines are pretty standard Node boilerplate for creating an HTTP server. In this case, we've got a handle request function, okay? That thing returns a promise, right? We say then we've got two handlers. The first one handles an actual response. Let's pretend it's an object that has status headers and content properties, and we can just return those in the response. Or in the case that it's an error, we want to know about it, log it to the console, but we still want to return a response, right? So give them a 500, right? And then the last line is just setting up the server and binding it to a port 3000. Does this make sense? Is this a real world problem that people are running into? Because I ran into this problem, and using callbacks, I didn't have any way to propagate the error all the way back to the top of the stack. Once I was deep into my callback stack, I didn't have any way to say, oh, here's an error, return a 500 to the user. Right? That makes sense? Anything you wanted to add to this piece?
Yeah, I just want to reiterate, yeah, we totally came to this problem in the same way. I was working on a pretty large web service for barnesandnoble.com. And this is exactly the problem we had is, how do we deal with errors in our server in a way that isolates them to the user? But we were very used to promises from our client-side work, and this is exactly what we wanted. Like, we wanted the ability to say, oh, deep down in the, when we've done the database lookup and the user exists, but we're looking up the bucket and there's no file in it, then we got to propagate up a 404. Well, we didn't have to, save a reference all the way to the top of the call stack or try and use domains and like get in trouble because of connection pooling. We instead just threw an error inside our promise chain. And because it's inside a promise chain, the promise chain knows, oh, he threw a 404 error, let me propagate that right back up. And it's this exact kind of thing that like is perfect for web servers where you have this kind of functional style where, I received some input, I'd like to give you back some output, and that output might be a return value or it might be an exception. So that's exactly what you want. Then there's a blog post making the rounds recently that promises are functional and callbacks are imperative. This is web servers are a pretty perfect match for the functional paradigm, right? They're stateless, they're input, you get output, and this is exactly what you want. So
we're just about done. Just one last note. If you're interested in writing HTTP servers like that, I've been playing around with some other guys on some ideas around writing promise-based HTTP servers. There's a library that we're calling mock. It might be, it's not fully specified yet. There's still a lot of things we still have to hash out. But I've been using it, I've been programming with it, and it feels really good. And pretty good performance, too, is what we've got on it. So so anyways, thank you. And if you have any questions, please. Denicola. Denicola.